So you're a philosopher?
Yes. 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 I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply.
In about 4 seconds, a teacher will begin to speak.
Much, Eugene. I appreciate it. I appreciate the opportunity to be here, to be a part of this series. Is it okay if I share my screen?
Oh, yep. I'm working on that right now. Oh, give me like 2 seconds.
Okay.
All right. You should be there.
Okay. Let me share that. And all right. So the topic today that Professor Pitchford has asked me to speak about is making government work for communities. I think people in general feel that government has left them behind and they are not heard. However, we fail to realize that collectively we have the power, and this is how to access and activate that power. So those are just a couple of the things that I want to talk about today. So the first three things I want to talk about today are power, access, and accountability. They work in tandem together with anyone that is interested in politics. And as a teacher, you know, I've had students ask me before, why we got to take this class? You know, I don't care about politics. And I always tell them, if you don't care about politics, you should care about politics, because politics touches every aspect of your life. There's no day, no place you can go that does not have some type of political influence. Even putting gas in your car, the price you pay is a political expense. So the fact that gas goes up and down, that's politics. You know, the fact that, you know, when you can vote, how you can vote, if you can vote, is political. So all of these things are of consequence, and the things that we should care about and that our students should care about. And I think starting early enough in life, being exposed to political access and to the way things work, helps us build the knowledge base of the electorate. So in speaking of power, access, and accountability, political power comes through the vote. And the question I want everybody to think about is, do you exercise yours? Now, I'm sure with people on this particular call, yes, we vote. We know that every 4 years there's a presidential election, you know, but a lot of people don't go beyond that. We think about the higher offices. You think about the White House. Every 4 years. You may even think about, you know, off-year elections, as they call them, or, you know, congressional elections, when it's time to vote for your congressman or your senator. However, the most important elections that you can take part in are your state legislative elections, your school board elections, and your municipal elections, that where you have to vote for your alders. People oftentimes, you know, people have won elected office with 5 votes, and that's only because 10, you know, 18 people showed up. It's sad, but the response comes from the lower the voter turnout, you get who you get. And if until you activate your power to in access to the voting booth, this is what happens. So the second part of that is access to the ballot box. Access to voting is essential and should be protected at all costs. Voter suppression is real. I'll say that again. Voter suppression is real. And if you don't think it is, we can have a conversation offline. I can give you a whole lot of pointers. There's a reason that Stacey Abrams is famous, because, you know, her organization has helped to mobilize voters in Georgia. The last part of this is accountability. It's not enough for us just to vote and say, okay, I got LaKeshia in office, I'm done. It's all on her. Let her figure it out. There's still some advocacy that has to come after that. There's still advocacy that has to come after that, and I still need help to do what it is that I can do in the Capitol. So the accountability piece falls on, number one, the electorate keeping me accountable and other folks that are elected for office accountable by saying, I didn't like the way you voted on this bill. Or, you know, when there are different bills coming out, the people say, I want you to vote for this, or I don't want you to vote for this, and this is the reason why. One of my colleagues always says, you know, if the phone rings one time and somebody says red shirt on Friday, she won't pay it any attention. Okay, somebody called and said red shirt on Friday. If 12 people call consecutively back to back to back and say, we want red shirts on Friday, now I'm paying attention, because this is something that's going on in the community where They want me to vote on a bill that says everybody has to wear a red shirt on Friday. So the more people that continue to call your office and to advocate for something, that's who gets the attention. When you don't call, that's when people say, oh, they don't care about that. Let me go ahead and go along with this. So I think that is a big part of it. So thinking about this as I continue with the presentation, power, access, and accountability, those are the three things that I want us to consider and to think about. So just a brief background about the division of powers. And I have to go here because I laugh. People laugh when I tell them this all the time. Every week, I probably get six calls telling me that the city of Milwaukee has not picked up somebody's trash. And I always say, well, I'm sorry they didn't pick up your trash, but let me point you in the direction of your alderperson who will be able to help you with that. And a lot of times we just believe everybody is elected and we can call them, but we don't understand how our government is set up from a division of power perspective. So understanding what federal level legislators do, what constitutional officers do, what statewide officers do, and what their purview is, and then municipal level officers as well. So when you think about the actual division of powers, this started way back in 1787 when we had our Constitution, you know, was started. We started off as a confederation of states, and we realized quickly that that did not work. In 1776, we can't let states just do their own thing. People were printing their own money, and your money wouldn't work in, you know, in Maryland to Virginia and different things like this. We said, okay, we got to make this a centralized government. So that's what happened. And we started the process of the division of powers in 1787. And the federalism that we have, that model has continued since that time. So that's why you have federal level government, you have statewide government, you have local and municipal government, and they are supposed to work in concert with each other, but always following that hierarchy of events. Let's see. So national powers that we have, they're considered expressed, implied, and inherent. So the federal government has the ability to levy taxes and to coin our money. That's why we have one federal currency. That's why the money that you use every day can be used in any state you go to and even our U.S. territories. When you look at implied powers, that's the elastic clause of the Constitution that says that, you know, the national government is required to carry out their express powers, but everything else is left to the states that they didn't specifically give instruction for. And the inherent powers are that the national government is able to exercise its power. We have the ability to raise an army and a navy and all of those things to protect our general welfare. So reserve powers belong specifically to the states. This is where your education comes from. The fact that we have statewide education that is mandated in each state, you have to have that. That comes from the state. The state is obligated to do certain things that were not expressly granted to the federal government. Now, they didn't talk about dollars, which is a deeper conversation, because we do have a United States Department of Education that can grant dollars that you take from that go to the federal government for our tax base and that can be given to states to operate how they see fit. And then there's a supremacy clause, which means that no state law may conflict with any national law. And we can see that in, you know, various times in our history when you think about, you know, the fact that it used to be illegal for interracial couples to get married. That was something that was a statewide issue, but then was added to the federal government. And they said, no, that's discriminatory. We're going to change that. And then now it's the law of the land in all of the 50 states, things like that. The abolition of slavery, that is a part of the supremacy clause. You have to get rid of that. That can no longer be the case. So when we think about state and local governments as well, I want you to understand what your state legislators do. We deal with the state budget, which is currently coming up right now. We're in the process of hearing what the governor has to say and what his priorities are for the state's budget. We deal with the state taxes as well as schools. So I know this is mostly a panel of educators and people concerned about education. Our school dollars and how we apply dollars to schools comes directly from the state government. So whether you are a person who, you know, if you're old as me or older, you understand what that fight was about probably 30 some years ago, where you had the issue with expanding parental choice programs and how those dollars would be allocated, the fact that we had the Chapter 220 program that was mandated by a federal judge to say that school districts had to integrate. And then we created the Chapter 220 program, which has now since been phased out because we created open enrollment. And so now a child can go to any school district as long as they have room, any public school district as long as they have room in that receiving district. So those are different ways in which the state government has access to you. We also deal with social service programs as well. So if there are SNAP benefits to be had, it comes from the USDA, but it's facilitated through the state. So items like that, that's what we deal with on a daily basis. Your local alderman, if you live in the city of Milwaukee or in Wauwatosa, you have alders, they deal with the city budget. City budgets can deal with fire and police. They can also deal with trash collection and whether you have a pothole on your street that you need to be filled. Now, the nuance there is that where does the county come in? Because we have a county-based system in Wisconsin. So our county-based system would fall under the purview of the state because the county is an extension of the state government. So these are just, it's kind of like a localized version of the state government. That's what your county board of supervisors does. We give them money to operate within their purview. So one of the things that I want to talk about as well is what citizens can do. A lot of people say, okay, you gave me all this information. Now what can I do about it? How can I access? And remember, we talked about power of the vote. We talked about accessibility. We talked about accountability. What can I do as a regular citizen who may not know everything I need to know about civics or how government works? The first thing is register to vote. So that's one of the first things you can do. The other thing beyond, I should have put a caveat there with registering to vote, is understand who and what you're voting for. A lot of times we had, and I'll give the perfect example, was when Governor Evers was running for office, there was a referendum that was on, a referendum question that was on the ballot that dealt with legalization of marijuana. And I had to tell a lot of people, they said, oh yeah, I'm voting for marijuana. I said, you're not voting for marijuana. You're voting to see whether it would be, it's something that you would agree with, whether it should be legalized in the state. So it wasn't something that was binding. There's non-binding and binding referendum. That was a non-binding referendum. It was a referendum question. So just asking the general public to give us your thoughts about this particular subject. There's still a long way to go in that particular conversation, if you've read the news lately, where now he wants to put it in the state budget to have us actually do the decriminalization and legalization of medicinal marijuana. So those are different things that they're talking about now. And they were like, I thought we did this already. We voted for that. I said, no, you voted on the question. Now it's time to actually put it into place and get the policy done, the policy part done with it. So first thing is registering to vote. 1A is understanding what you're voting for. And the second thing is to participate in elections. It's not enough for us to just say, oh, we have a million people registered to vote. But if they don't show up, we still have the same situation where we have low turnout in school board elections, low turnout in municipal elections. And people are like, but I didn't like this person. You said, did you and all your friends get together and say, this is who we're not voting for? That's the question that you have to ask yourself. How does that advocacy work? And trying to get people in your voting block to participate in the election. The third thing I would say is joining a political party. Now, we know we have two large big tent parties with the Republican and Democratic parties. There are also other political parties that you can join. And I would say do research and find out where your ideologies lie. I would also say don't become a single issue voter because that can be dangerous. When people choose one thing and they said, this is what I care about above anything else, and they don't look at the nuances of other aspects of what a particular party may care for. So you may believe in fiscal conservatism, but you may also believe in a person's right to choose, okay? So you may want to look at those things and look at where those political actions take place in either party of the Big Ten parties or in a third party. There is a lot of buzz about creating third parties. They've happened in the past. We've not always had just two major parties. There were ideological differences that create political parties. The first parties that we had in the country were the Federalist Party and the Anti-Federalist Party. And they were debating basically whether we wanted to have a whether we wanted to have a centralized government or to have states run everything for themselves. So that's something that you have to think about. The other thing I would say would be joining advocacy groups for issues that matter to you. You may say, you know what, I don't like either political party of the two that are the main parties, but I believe in environmental justice. So I'm going to go join Greenpeace, or I want to hear more about what other environmental groups to do. You may believe highly in education. So I love education. That's something that I'm passionate about. I'm a member of the NAACP because they have a strong education committee, and they do a lot of activism about educating the public on education issues. If you believe in social justice is something that there are a plethora of organizations that you can join. The People's Revolution, if you like to be a person that wants to march and be on foot and talk about social justice issues, you can continue to educate yourself and also begin to educate your community about these issues if you join advocacy groups, because they are things that matter to you. So I'm going to pause there. And if we have any questions, I'll be sure to take them. They can be political questions. I'll answer them. You know, questions that you have, but I don't know why this is the way it is. I'm very open and want to be transparent. So, Professor Pittsburgh.
Yep. Okay. So this one was texted me while you were talking. It's not in the chat box, but someone texted to me. Does the average politician understand why young people may just be disengaged? It's not a question directed towards you. It's just like lumping the politicians together. Do they understand why a young person may be disengaged? Is it even on the radar?
I think now it is on, is starting to become on the radar for a lot of people. Because when you look at the fact that millennials, and I'm a millennial, I'm considered an old millennial or an exennial, somebody who was born in the 80s that, you know, that still gets it. But then you think about people that are in the generation behind me. When you look at activism and power, we have to cultivate voters. So I think when you look at, even from the big tent party perspective, there are youth groups and college groups that are available for both, on both sides, where you may have a young Republicans club, a young Democrats society, where people are already activated. But those are usually students and kids who have grown up being at least introduced to politics. I think when you look at the body politic for the younger generation, there has to be a lot of work that needs to be done, because a lot of our young people are passionate about issues, and issues are taking precedence because they're activating themselves around issues. And when you look at the average age of politicians, especially federal politicians, the average age is probably about 70 years old. So there is a vast disconnect between a fresh 18-year-old that's ready to vote and a person that's 70 plus. And you're like, how does a 70 plus person reach a person that's 18? You have to go where they are. The messaging cannot continue to be the same. How many people have cut the cord and don't have cable in their homes? But if I want to reach an 18-year-old, I'm going to Instagram, because that's where they are. And if you want to shepherd those ideas, you have to go where young people are. And you can't be afraid to use mechanisms and modalities that they use. So that would be more so social media, making sure that you have, surrogates that they can identify with. If I'm running for office on a national level, I'm going to use somebody that a young person would identify with. I'm going to call a Draymond Green. I'm going to be as a type of product. You're just peddling your ideology and what you believe in, as you know, under a political auspice. So you have to use everything that's at your disposal.
All right. I think we have a question from Adriana.
Yeah. How best is it when you have to operate in as like a political minority? Because where I am not the same as the people around me. And I've kind of got backlash from that recently. So like, how best do you deal with like that gracefully?
You know what? I will tell you that there is a blessing in being in the minority, because you get to do a lot of talking to people. And my goal is always to educate. You may not change everybody's hearts and minds on certain subjects, but you may be able to change and impact policy. So if I can come to a consensus with someone that we can agree, we have 10 things that we're supposed to be doing, and we can agree on five, I'm going to pass a bill that gets me to the midpoint and get me to that five, because politics is about give and take. So you have to do that part. I would also say, and I'm going to give you the best advice I can give you, this is a LaKeshia Myers advice, is embrace the backlash, because it's necessary. You don't get anywhere by not challenging and bucking authority, because people will do things and shroud it in other things. We can shroud things in religion, we can shroud them in tradition, and we don't even understand why we're doing something. I heard a minister one time talk about his wife making a roast. She had a pan and she would cut the butt of the roast off. And she did this her, you know, whole cooking experience. And he asked her one day, why do you cut the end of the roast off? And she said, I don't know. My mother always cut the end of the roast off. She called her mother and said, Mom, why did you cut the end of the roast off? She said, because my pan was too short. I didn't have enough room. So we do things that we see, but we may not even know the impetus behind them. So we can't always operate within that sphere. So that would be something I tell you. Embrace the backlash, because if you get along with people 100% of the time, something is wrong. And I tell this to people all the time. That me and Professor Pitchford do this all the time. I say, Eugene, I don't think like that. Well, I'm just saying, I think you should think about it this way. So that's the good back and forth that comes from that. And that is the embrace that you can have with other people. I have friends that are on the opposite aisle of me. And when we get into conversations and they say, well, you're not thinking about it from this perspective. I say, yeah, but you're missing a whole swath of people by not thinking about it from this perspective. So what can we do to get to a midpoint? And I think that a lot of it, I know it's so vitriolic now, or, you know, it has been with, you know, people trying to stand firm for their side. But you can be in the minority and get things done. One of the best people that gets things done in the state legislature is Senator Lena Taylor. And that's because she has built a network of people that are both Republicans and Democrats. And she's able to meet in the midpoint with people and say, okay, if I can lessen the impact from what's going to happen from this particular piece of legislation, I've done good for my community, because I'm able to get us to a midpoint where it won't be so detrimental to this group of people, but this group of people can also live with it and be happy.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
All right, LaKeshia, we may have time for one more if okay. There's another one floating out there. This is like I hope you all understand, like we often don't get a chance to talk with our elected officials like this, and or an honest conversation. Like, so I know like she's being like brutally honest with you all. So like please count that as a unique opportunity. Any more questions on any other questions? All right, LaKeshia, seeing that I don't see questions, can you do this? Okay. Like, do you have a space where you have your contact information so people can, like, if there's further questions, people want to get to you directly or privately or?
Yes. Okay. I can put it, I can share it with everyone. I'll put my contact information in the chat and feel free to reach out.
LaKeshia, while you're putting that in the chat, I just have like a wild question for you. Like, I'm gonna give you a Eugene question.
Oh gosh.
Like, so when the politicians really begin, like when they are like on TV and they're like in their feelings and going back and forth, like, is it like real beef or is it like fake beef? Like, do they go out to eat together? Like, what is happening off camera?
Can be a bit of both. There are a lot of times that political theater does take place and we already know what's going to happen, but people are going to make impassioned speeches and you already know what the end result is going to be because you've lined up your votes and you know how it's going to happen. But there are other opportunities where there will be some real beef. You know, it can be people that really dislike each other and you will see that happen. And that can happen a lot of time at the federal level or at the state level. So it just depends on what the issue is. So I think that is something that it's a bit of both. So the political theater aspect of it is yes, because you can see spin happen on anything. You know, there have been times when you'll see, you just talk to a person and then the political spin that they send out to their constituents will say something totally different. You're like, really? I just talked to you about that. And that's not how this went. But, you know, this is something that that they have to do in order to save face to a certain extent, because people bank on the American elite. That's something that people shouldn't do, because things can change, you know, heavily. I know several people that identify as Republicans, but were upset to learn about the handling of the COVID-19 crisis. And that was one of the deciding factors in, that made them choose a different candidate this time around, because that's something that affected their lives personally. There are farmers that exist that, you know, have switched parties because they said, you know what, the sanctions with China are such that I'm losing business every day and I wasn't able to continue, you know, offering the products that I have. So everything happens in a cyclical fashion to a certain extent. So some of it, yes, is political theater. Other, you know, bits of it can be, no, you really messed up this time. And I don't know that we can repair that. Or, you know, it'll take time to try to repair that relationship.
All right. So, Derek, you got a 10-second question, and Lakeisha's going to give you a 10-second response. Lakeisha, don't you give me a 3-minute response here. Come on, okay. Derek.
Okay. Darn, I'm probably echoing here. Hold on a second. Okay. All right. So, just a quick question as to, we know that the order of operation of government, the federal laws normally trumps the state laws. But do you ever find that any particular cases where you have to challenge federal law from the state level? Have you had some situations where you've had to challenge the federal guidelines or federal law based on the Constitution?
Yes, there are several instances that I can give you in keeping with what Eugene wants me to do. The best example I can give you is Brown versus Board of Education. That stemmed from 1896 with a separate but unequal clause that was with Plessy versus Ferguson, which allowed for legalized segregation. But it was a state law and several different state laws that gave us the Brown case that would then go on to desegregate schools. So that happened also with other cases that dealt with segregation on public transit, other things like that. So you got the entire federal law changed within the span of 50, 60 years because it was something that needed, or 80 years, that was something that needed to happen. Because we've seen our laws change all the time. I mean, it's a process, but usually state law has standing in federal court. So that's how they'd be able to change it.
Okay. Just real quick though, anything Wisconsin-wise or anything within the last 20 years that you can think of that where the state had to challenge federal guideline or federal law?
Yes, absolutely. With school choice. School choice is one of the state guidelines that had to change because it was a federalized case. We had to go to federal court to allow religious and sectarian schools to be able to get authorization for state tax dollars to be used. So that was absolutely something that had to go to federal level.
All right, LaKeisha, we definitely thank you. Thank you for providing your contact information. Your schedule is probably the busiest out of us all. So if you got to leave, we understand. But if you can stay,
thank
that's
you.
Fine too. So either way.
And I just want to say hello to my soror, Shanae. Thank you for your support. And I appreciate meeting everybody.
And Shanae's presenting last. So if you come back a little later, she'll be on.
Absolutely.
And, but we definitely appreciate you. So, all right, y'all, that's LaKeisha Myers.
We hope you enjoyed this edition of the I Have a Story to Tell podcast. Until the next time, hug someone, love someone, and tell your story.